I'm Dr. Claire Cousins from the University of Edinburgh, and I am looking for life on Mars using robotic missions by sending rovers to the surface of Mars to explore rocks and see what evidence of life might have been left behind from anything alive perhaps 4 billion years ago. If I was to describe my research to my 12-year-old self, I would say that I go to places on Earth which are very like the kinds of places that we find on other planets. So I go to places like Iceland, where there's lots of volcanoes, where there's lots of glaciers, and use all the rocks and all the crazy environments that we find there to understand more about how we can look for life on other planets. I think the chances of finding non-oxygen breathing but still water-dependent forms of life on other planets is, I like to think it's relatively high, in the sense that I very much see biology as a natural consequence of just standard physics and standard chemistry coming together with the right set of conditions. And those conditions may not have been right on all planetary bodies. You know, for example, in our own solar system, we can see that Earth is obviously, you know, abundantly full of life, whereas other planets in our solar system, you know, appear very much dead. And that doesn't mean that earlier on in their history they were also devoid of life. So with Mars, for example, a lot of attention is focused on exploring Mars, and especially exploring those rocks which were laid down perhaps, you know, 3 or 4 billion years ago, because the environments were very much different then. We saw lots of evidence for abundant liquid water. There was a lot more geological activity, so there were hydrothermal systems. There were places that life could have actually have survived or indeed done really well. So it's all about looking back into the history of a planet as well as seeing what it's like at its present day. And I think when we look back into the history, when we see that the environment is right, I like to think that that the prospect for life having evolved or originated is also likely there as well. So contrasting to what a lot of people think that scientists do, I don't typically spend most of my time in a lab coat, kind of looking at things down a microscope. For example, yesterday I spent most of my day actually defrosting a freezer, which was a not terribly exciting part of science. But other days I might be doing field work, for example. So I might be planning that field work, so planning where we're going to go and what samples we want to collect and what size of car we need to hire to drive through giant rivers and that kind of thing, to analysing data on a spreadsheet, so just on a computer and just ploughing through numbers that we've collected in a lab. The thing that made me want to do science and become a scientist was really wanting to understand more about all the things that we just don't know. So all the questions that you have in your mind, you know, whether it's looking up into the night sky and looking at all the different stars that you can see in your back garden and wondering what they are or how far away they are, to understanding whether or not we're the only form of life in the entire universe as we know it. And our local solar system is basically our sort of our back door, really, you know, our back garden, and we're looking into this sort of environment to try and understand, you know, if we are in fact alone, if we have evidence of life in other places. So I think it's all about asking those questions, which, you know, you always have in your mind, and especially when you're a kid as well, when you're young, you're always asking questions, you know, and when you speak to children now, they always have a whole bunch of really cool questions of things they've observed, and they want to understand why something is the way it is. So becoming a scientist was really all about kind of continuing that fascination in a way that, you know, you can get paid for.